this is Stewart Copeland, and you are listening to Rodrigo on Sonic Perspective.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another interview of Sonic Perspectives. I'm Rodrigo, and with me today is one of the most influential drummers of all time, Mr. Stewart Copeland. Stewart, it's an honor to talk to you, and thank you for joining us.
Pleasure to be here with you.
Let's start with your most recent endeavor, an art collection called What is Art? What is this about?
Well, some actual artists called me up, and they have this concept where they give me drumsticks with lights on them, and I blaze around on the drums, and they take the images created by that, and turn it into something that they describe as art. Then, when they've made these images and messed around with them, then I go in there and I put a few dabs of paint on it and screw around with it and mess it up even more. And they say it's art. What is art? Who knows?
I know.
If you like it, if you'll put it on your wall, it's art.
Absolutely. And I've seen other drummers do something similar. I think Chad Smith did it as well.
Yes.
Sheila E. And I think Mike Mangini was involved in something similar a few years ago.
Well, drums are very visual, so I
yeah.
guess it's an obvious mark for some creative art guy to get into.
It's magical how a drummer goes around his kit, right?
Well, to me it is. I think there are some singers who would rather we went around the kit a little bit less.
I bet. And in parallel with that, you did a few shows with Oysterhad this year, more than a decade after you played together for the last time. How did those shows go?
Oh, it was too much fun. We'd all forgotten how much fun Oysterhad was, which was pretty darn fun. And they're big shows with a big audience, a big arena, packed arena. So it feels like an important event. But unlike, for instance, a Police show, which is all business. It's all, we play the hits, we know what the hits are, and it's the verse, and then the chorus, and then the big, you know, hook. In Oysterhad, we just go out there and make it up for 2.5 hours. And we have some loose concepts of material, but mostly we go out there and just ham it up. And the people who buy tickets for this bizarre show, that's what they come for. They want to see something that has never happened before and will never happen again. And they want to see us think. And by God, they get to see us think. But it is really exciting.
It is indeed, yeah.
It has a different kind of energy, which is very different from what I'm used to. I mean, I write music for symphony orchestra, which is absolutely every note is on the page with no deviation. And even with a normal pop group, you can screw around a little bit, but the verse comes where the verse comes, and the chorus goes. But with Oysterhad, anything can happen. And so there's an excitement of throwing ourselves off the cliff to see what happens. And the people who come out, well, that's what they want.
Yeah, absolutely. I know the last dates of the tour are now postponed for next year. Are there any plans to do more after that?
Well, once again, this is sort of like the Police, where we forgot about it 20 years ago. Or actually, no, we played Bonnaroo 14 years ago, I think.
Yeah.
And then we remembered how much fun it was, but we've all got careers. We got stuff that we're doing and kind of left it sitting there on the shelf. And then when we pull it off the shelf, there is an enormous, crazy amount of interest that surprises us. And so we did the one show, but then all these other, you know, all this excitement is created. So we're still scratching our heads about how much to do. Obviously, not much in the year of our Lord 2020, but
yes.
Next year, we'll see what happens.
Yeah, I know the nature of the band has always been more towards improvising than actual studio albums. There's one so far, but I'd love it if you guys could release another one.
Doing a couple shows is really easy, and it's really a lot of fun, and that's sort of our raison d'etre, is to do these, to play in front of an audience and to get that vibe from the audience. Going into a studio is a very different kind of exercise, and it's not really so relevant to the band's purpose.
I see.
But yeah, you know, we may be inspired to go and make another record. But really, it's about playing shows.
Okay. And another initiative you're involved with is the Police Deranged for Orchestra. What exactly is that?
That is today's mission. This is what I'm doing right here as I'm sitting at my desk.
Oh, okay.
It's a kind of a long story as to what the derangements are, but the orchestra part is easy. I in the last few years, I've been playing concerts of my concerti with orchestras around the world, and it's a lot of fun to do. I've learned how to play very quietly within the environment of a symphony orchestra. And it's all very dignified, makes me feel like an actual musician. It's a whole different world. But recently it was suggested to me that these derangements that I made of police songs would make excellent material for the orchestra. Okay, now that's the easy part. Okay, it's Stew Daddy with an orchestra. Okay, now the police derangements part is a longer story. And these derangements come from an exercise many years ago when I made my Super 8 movie, Everyone Stares. I discovered that I had all of this footage that I shot back in the day with the police. And since they, you know, since I shot it all and it was sitting, the canisters of film were sitting in shoeboxes, one day they invented computers. And then pretty soon after that, they invented software where I can sit at home and make a movie out of all my footage that I shot myself. And I made this movie called Everyone Stares, which played at Sundance and showed on Showtime, and it is now a DVD. You can actually buy it. It's called Everyone Stares.
I have it.
good. Yeah. Okay, now the music for Everyone Stares is the derangements. And what the derangements are, I took police music to score the movie. I took studio recordings, live recordings, multi-track, stereo, and created this kind of collage of police sounds and songs. And I took the words from this song and I put them over the bass line from that song, and I took that solo that Andy played in Atlanta in 1979 and I put it over the, you know, the 1982 version of whatever, and created this music, which was for the film, to score the film. But now they're very cool arrangements, and I'm taking those versions of the police songs and I'm orchestrating it for the orchestra. So we won't just be playing Roxanne. We will be playing a lot of the improvisations that we used to do on stage and throwing in lyrics from the wrong song, and so on. So they're sort of like lobotomized mashups of the police material. And it all comes from what Andy or Sting played sometime, somewhere. But as I'm orchestrating it, I'm developing it out, building it out into a whole new soundscape. But you'll recognize the songs.
Oh, okay. Cool name, by the way, The Range for Orchestra.
Yes.
So there will be vocals, right? How are you going to handle the vocals, or who's going to do it?
Well, Andy and Sting are, of course, very difficult to replace. In fact, impossible to replace. The closest I can get is three African-American singer ladies for Sting and 50 orcs for Andy.
That would be interesting to see.
I did do some songs. In my last tour with the orchestras, I did some police songs, you know, more obscure ones just because they were interesting. And in the context of the other material that I was playing, they kind of fit. But this time I'm doing hits, the big ones.
Okay.
And that'll be interesting because it opens up a whole different set of shows. I can now play the Henley Festival, which is not fine art. Most of the things I do is fine arts. And I'm on the bill with Ravel and Stravinsky.
Yeah.
This is a whole different world where I'm on the bill with Elton John and ABBA. But they're fantastic shows. I get to play with great orchestras in a beautiful summer evening in England, or, you know, it's just a lot of fun, fun environment.
Let me ask you about Gizmodrome. You guys did an album in 2017, and that was it. I was expecting this to be your new band, so to speak, and a bigger tour.
So was I. It was a lot of fun to do. And when we actually brought it to the marketplace, we got great reviews, and there was a lot of excitement, but we couldn't get enough interest in doing shows to support the band. And we played a place in Italy where Adrian Belew noticed that if he played there himself as Adrian Belew, he would have done better than Adrian plus Mark King and Stewart. I mean, it's sort of like nobody's ever heard of Gizmodrome.
Yeah.
And it's the worst band name in history. It used to be just Gizmo. When we played in Italy, it was Gizmo. But then when we made a record and we went out into the world, there's 10 other gizmos out there, so we had to come up with a different name. And we ended up with Gizmodrone. Is it Gizmodrodo? Gizmo... What's the name of the band again? Worst band name in history. But the record was cool. And the fun thing about the shows was that I got to be in the front of the stage with a guitar and do the singing and bang it away on a guitar. Now, we've got Adrian Belew in the band, which meant that he plays all the real guitar parts, but I could just hit the E, A, and D chords and do histrionic guitar hero poses while singing these songs. And we had Mark King's drummer from Level 42, Pete Ray Biggin, on the drums. I played some drums. You know, he played most of the drums, but I played some as well. But mainly, I felt like an old lion with a young lion, you know, real happy to have a young lion around the house to do all the hard work. And I look back at Pete Ray Biggin on the drums, and man, he is blazing, working so hard. And it turns out that playing guitar is a piece of cake. That ain't working. Just standing there looking handsome most of the time. And I look back at Pete, and he is working up a sweat, I think, for 50 years. The other guys in the band never let on, never shared their dirty little secret that they're hardly working. And I'm in the back of the stage working my ass off for half a century without any inkling that those other guys at the front of the stage are hardly even breaking a sweat. It did cross my mind sometimes when we would go on stage and I'm in a T-shirt and they're like wearing jackets and hats and fancy clothes. Well, how come I can't wear a jacket and fancy clothes? Because I'm sweating too much, because I'm working too hard. Playing guitar, that's just fun. I really enjoyed that part.
And you sang and played guitar on Clark Kent, too.
Yes.
This was a different experience for you, I guess, with Gizmodrome.
Well, it was very similar, in fact, in the singing and playing guitar part. But I had other people on keyboards, bass, guitar, and drums.
By the way, one thing the fans ask about a lot is if there's a chance of reissuing the Clark Kent album.
One of these days, definitely. It's sort of like Oysterhad, where I'm going to do it. Just sit tight, you know, don't touch that dial, I'm going to do it. And then 20 years go by.
No. Come on, man. We're waiting
for
this.
Life is rich, right? Life is rich and full of stuff. Like, right now, I'm doing these derangements, which I'm really glad to be locked in my tower here with the phone not ringing to focus on this. And then there's an opera in Germany, then there's an opera in Italy, then there's this, then there's that, and then there's more Oysterhad shows. But one of these days, folks, I promise you.
Okay.
I'm going to get that Clark Kent stuff. In fact, I have another Clark Kent track, which I recorded here at the Sacred Grove, and video. When the world is deserving, when the humanity has behaved itself, I will reward it with this Clark Kent track that I have in the cookie jar.
If that's one requirement, it's going to take a while, I guess.
Yeah, so stand up straight, folks. Do your homework, eat your vegetables, and Clark Kent will return.
Oh, wow. One thing I liked about Gizmodrome as well is that you played a lot of songs from The Police, which had zero chance of being played in the 80s, like Miss Gradenko, Bombs Away, Darkness. It must have been quite fun for you to dust off those songs and play them, right?
Yes, it was. You know, you're right. Those songs, we never bothered with those songs in The Police because we had, Don't Stand So Close to Me, Message in a Bottle, Roxanne. We had kind of like other songs that were better, mostly. So, yes, we were playing the obscure ones with Gizmodrome.
Yeah. And I noticed on the kit you used for Gizmodrome, and I think also with Oysterhad, you got rid of the octobuns on your kit.
Yes.
That was such a signature Stewart thing. Are you not using them anymore, or?
I don't. They take up space. And the other thing is, where I sit with the orchestra nowadays, I sit, as you're facing the orchestra from the audience, I'm way over on the right-hand side of the stage facing the conductor. So I'm sideways on to the audience. If I had on my left, if I had those octobands there, I would be obscured by, you know, a wall of octobands. And they're just an effect anyway. They're not, you know, give me a triangle and I'll do something cool with it. I guess I get tired of lugging them around.
I see.
And by the way, I never needed all eight of them or however many I used to have. You know, two will do, or one, or two.
Fair enough. Okay. So you do miss being in the context of a band, right? You wish that Gizmodrome would go a little bit further, right? And to sort of tour and record.
It's fun. You know, I enjoy my life as a composer, working by myself, and complete control of everything, master of the universe. But there is a camaraderie in a band that's just good fun. I mean, you have to share decision-making, and what your idea of is a good idea, you have to run it past the other guys, and, you know, they may agree, they may not agree. and there's a negotiation. But that's fun, you know. I'm the fourth sibling in my family, the youngest of four, so I'm pretty used to team play. I'm comfortable in that situation.
And speaking of the operas that you mentioned, I know you had a diverse musical upbringing, but writing a whole opera seems like quite an undertaking. How did it first occur to you that you were able to do this?
Many years ago, when I was young and arrogant. Now I am old and arrogant. But I wrote an opera for I wrote a ballet for the San Francisco Ballet, which seemed like an easy thing, and it came from the fight director of the Francis Coppola movie that was my first film score. The fight director was the director of San Francisco Ballet, who commissioned a ballet. So, sure, why not? And so I wrote that. And during the course of that, someone said, well, you're going to write another one. I said, sure, when I finish my opera. And an opera company in Cleveland heard that and said, when you finished your opera, can we do it? And I was joking. I'm not writing an opera. But they said, well, why don't you? So I did. And that was in the 80s. 86 maybe, and since then I've written five more operas, and the one I'm working on right now I just sent to the German National Opera. It's called The Electric Saint, and it's about Nikola Tesla, the inventor of the modern world, pretty much, and his struggles with Thomas Edison and J.P. Morgan and Westinghouse. And I've written a few of them now, and it's a very complex medium. And a lot of the technique that I learned was during 20 years as a film composer, how music interacts with drama, how you tell a story with music, you know, how you make people happy and sad, and using music to specifically direct emotions one way or the other. And also using the orchestra as well. I learned how to do that in the course of my life as a flinty-eyed, hired gun film composer. So all these chops come together in opera. Now, I never really liked opera that much until I started writing it. And now I've drunk the Kool-Aid, and I actually love that sound now. But the possibilities for a composer are endless. It is the most fun that a composer can have with his clothes on.
I bet. So how did a guy like you, who listened to Ravel and Stravinsky as a kid, end up in the Police, a punk band? Not only that, you formed the band.
Willfully. Well, I was angry. I was a young, angry young man in my early 20s, playing in a art rock band called Curved Air, which was actually a really good gig. You know, it had been famous many years before, and I was the last rat to jump aboard the sinking ship, as I'm fond of saying. But it was at the end of the hippie boom, and it was just old and, you know, had been done by then. And then this punk thing started happening in London, and I was too young to be a hippie anyway. I was the last of the baby boom. And so the hippie thing was way old, but this new thing, I was 2 years older than the Clash. But it seemed like a better fit, so I immediately leapt into this new scene where it was do-it-yourself. I could book the gig myself. We get to a gig. We don't need all that stuff that art rock bands, prog rock bands carry around. We could just do it, and it was we could do it ourselves. I could borrow the money and record that record. You know, Sting, Henry Padovani, and I were stuffing singles into the picture sleeves our goddamn selves, and I would get on the phone myself, and I would sell boxes of 25 discs to record stores around the country, and they would send me the check, which I would split with Sting and Henry. And it was all about self-activation, because by the time I came around with Curved Air, I mean, even Curved Air was an established band, but the doors were locked, the walls were so high, the industry was just this closed circuit, old boy network kind of. You know, nothing was real. It was all about airplay, and it just wasn't real. But the visceral feeling on the streets of London, which just get out and do it. And we had a huge hits, by the way. We only sold 2,000 records, but every penny of that 2,000 records went into our pockets. That's a hit. Curved Air would sell 20,000 records, and we wouldn't even recoup. So we were, without any airplay, without any chart success at all, for us, putting money into our pockets, they were big hits. And then eventually we started to have actual hits.
Less luggage for you to carry, literally and figuratively, with punk, right?
Absolutely. We were fake punks. I mean, it must be understood that we were not the real thing. The real punks were snotty-nosed kids, 18 years old, who only knew two chords, but had that attitude that made them fun to watch and fun to, you know, the fun thing. And it really took away a lot of the expertise that is required, because music made by specialists is a modern invention. Music should be played by everybody, you know, around the campfire. You don't have to be Eric Clapton. You can be just a normal human being. Normal Homo sapiens are very good at music. Everybody can sing a song. Everybody can dance in time to the music. Music is actually really easy for us humans. The whole being Eric Clapton level of musicianship is a specialty item that isn't what music is really all about. And the punk movement reminded me of that anyway. And so we would just go out there and burn it up. Of course, it turned out that Sting was really sophisticated. And when Andy joined the group with his harmonic sensibilities, it actually became pretty sophisticated in spite of our original intention. But it was so beautiful that we wrote it.
Yeah, another thing that I would add is also playing punk with a traditional grip, which must have raised a few eyebrows in the beginning, I guess.
Not so much, because I don't think people noticed. Later on, people noticed, because nobody plays with traditional grip anymore. And the young musicians, you know, it's sort of like listening to jazz. Yeah, I'm into Coltrane. I know who Coltrane is. Yeah, Ed Thigpen. Yeah, Billy Joe Jones. I know who that is. Mm. And orthodox grip is sort of old school cool in that same kind of way. You know, Chad Smith plays like a monster with matched grip, but he can, just to be cool, just with a twinkle in his eye, he can go orthodox. He's got some chops on the old orthodox there.
So one thing I noticed about the history of the band and punk in general is that, like you said, you rebelled against the excesses of prog rock and the hippie movement.
By the way, I can now come out of the closet and share with the world that I am, in fact, you guessed it, prog.
Oh, yeah. Pro credentials,
yeah,
for sure.
I'm proud of it now.
Yeah.
I mean, at the time, we had to hide. But now I'm prog and proud.
Finally, eh?
Yeah.
But, I was saying that as time went on, the Police itself got a little bit more refined to the point where you guys added backing vocalists in the horn section on stage.
Yeah, everybody hated that.
Was there ever a realization of you becoming the thing that you rebelled against?
Yeah, no problem, though, because we weren't really rebelling against anything. We were just trying to find some other way of getting over the wall or through the wall. No, we had no scruples. I wrote a manifesto, but none of us believed it.
Punk manifesto in the beginning, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I still got it.
Oh, wow. So was that a unanimous decision of the three of you to add those elements, or was there conflict in the band about that?
No conflict. It was mostly Sting's doing, because one day, Sting is like this. He should have been throttled at birth. He can pick up any instrument, and within 10 minutes, something beautiful is happening. He picked up the saxophone, and suddenly he's like Tower of Power. And when we were making that album, which was the second to the last album called Ghost in the Machine, he was playing saxophone. You know, he was at the mics. He's supposed to be singing a song, but he's got the saxophone was around his neck at all times. And he would just start playing sax parts. And so he built up all these sax parts. And so when we did the tour of that album, sure, let's have some guys come and play those parts on stage. And the singing, the backing singers, that was actually the next tour, Synchronicity. And that's because he builds these very rich harmonic choruses that are three voices or more. And that's kind of the way the chorus is supposed to sound. And he also made the mistake of doing them all very high. Years later, he's got, oh my God, I can't have that high note. Oh, can you? Here we go. Hey! You know, poor fucker has to sing those notes, you know. So he had the clever idea of getting three girls on stage to sing those damn high notes. And I thought it was great. I loved the brass section and I loved having the girls, but the audience and the critics all hated it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I guess they have a point, because it is kind of cool to see three guys just three guys doing it.
Yeah, that was my thinking as well. But anyway, what happened happened. I want to ask you about another piece of your kit, which is not long gone, but that was another thing you pioneered, the Simmons pads. Do you still have yours?
No, I didn't have those for very long because it turned out there were many ways of triggering the synthesizer. Pew, 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 you know, and pretty soon everybody had them and it was all over every crap, you know, record. And so that didn't last very long. But the other one that I did pull out recently for Oysterhad was the delay line. I haven't used that since I didn't even use that on the reunion tour. I just forgot all about that technology. But I pulled it out for the Oysterhad and had a lot of fun with that with Oysterhad.
So did you get what you were searching for with the reunion of 2007, 2008?
Yes.
Was there any kind of discussion about a possible new album then?
Yes. Only problem was that whenever Sting would... the pressure was on him, not on me or Andy. Everyone just assumed that Andy and I would be in. So Sting felt it. But before anyone can go anywhere, they're not looking at Andy and I to write songs for the Police. Sting writes songs for the Police. And he just froze up. We really appreciated playing Message in a Bottle and Roxanne in front of people for whom those songs have huge impact. You know, 30 years at that time of people's lives, whether they're fans of the song or not, they heard it. It goes over the radio. It's part of everyone's life. It's the tapestry of humanity. You know, those songs have baggage. They have power that you can only get when they're in your head for a lifetime. New songs don't have that. And we enjoyed playing those classic songs together because of the effect that they had. That's sort of why we become musicians, is to light up a stadium in that way. But new material takes us back to the things that we don't have in common. And really, there's a lot that we do not have in common. With great love and admiration in our hearts, we recognize that music has a different function in our lives for each of us. For some, it's an escape into a beautiful place. For others, it's a celebration and time to burn down the building and make some noise. And these two visions are not necessarily... When we were young, they were compatible and they inspired each other. But at this point, I'm not very good at being a mouse. and when you've written a song with beautiful lyrics that have sophistication and nuance and subtlety, you don't need World War III going on behind your left shoulder. And so playing Message in a Bottle and Roxanne was great. Writing a new album gave us all the cold shakes.
Well, I don't blame you, because there's so much criticism with the internet and social media these days. Even if you did another Sgt. Pepper's, I guess it would never reach the expectation of the old-time fans or of everybody, right?
You know, you can't think that way. You're right. People would criticize you no matter what you do, and they do. Fortunately, with the Police, we got a pretty good ride. We got criticized in the beginning for being fake funks, which was true. The good, bad, and the ugly, you just got to put up with that. If you're going to be in show business in front of a lot of people, you got to put up with that. And it's never really a factor. What are people going to think is never going to slow you down.
Okay, fair enough. One thing I can probably guess is that one side effect of the reunion is that you guys had this newfound mutual respect for each other, right? Because the first time you did it, I guess it didn't end that well.
Actually, it did end well. The ending was well, but just before the ending was not well at all. The albums became more and more difficult to record and more frustrating for each of us for different reasons. And we now realize they were honest reasons. It wasn't jealousy. It wasn't evil. It wasn't satanic desire to cause ill. You know, they're all legitimate reasons why we did not get along so well. Making the albums was hell. We were in Montserrat. You open your eyes and it's paradise, but open your heart and we were killing each other. It just was hell on earth. And at the end of the day, we were very pleased with the result, but getting there, oh, God. And then we went out on tour, and we saw the power of those songs, and we were playing, you know, when we were playing shows around the world, that's when we got the buzz, when we were in front of audiences, when it was just three of us in the studio. We had to have men in white coats preventing us from axing each other. but when we play shows in front of people, that's an entirely different environment. And so we realized at the end of the touring involved with the last album that we couldn't go in to do another album. We just couldn't face it. We were all getting kinds of opportunities and invitations to other things to do outside of band life because the Police was a golden cage. Very exciting, but very limiting. It's like being in the Army. You know, your life doesn't belong to you. I have friends of mine who are in really big bands, and it's just a fact of life that when they're off tour, they're normal people with nothing going on, but then, okay, the tour is here. I now am owned by the group. And the reunion tour was like that, too. We had to join the Army for 2 years, and my finger doesn't belong to me. It belongs to the tour. And so we were enjoying ourselves at the end of the, whenever it was, 83, 84, when we very amicably said, you know what, let's not book that next Australian leg of the tour. Let's play Australia, and then that's it, Melbourne. That's the last show. And let's shake hands and get on with all these other cool things that life has to offer.
I understand.
So it actually ended well the first time, but that was kind of unfinished business, and the reunion tour was really great, reminding us of how cool it all was.
So you got a sense of closure as well from that reunion, right?
Yeah.
I guess. Yeah. Okay.
And also, through spending time with each other, got to understand each other a little better.
And speaking of your drumming style, listening to your music with all the bands that you were a part of, it gives us that off-kilter kind of feel. How did you develop that style? What's your secret?
Well, the secret is that I'm off-kilter. I'm still looking for the kilter. Where the fucking kilter? I want to get on it. And so other members of the band would wish that I would find that fucking kilter and get on kilter.
But do you find that your approach has changed through the years, or do you approach drumming in the same way as before? Or?
Not really different. I have two different worlds, which are almost two different guys. The composer guy is a sensitive intellectual, softly spoken, and considerate and contemplative, and I write the music and, you know, great music for the orchestra, the symphony, the opera, and so on, and it's very rich and very textured, and it's all, I create it, and I put it on the page, and I go and I take it to the Chicago Symphony, and it's all very dignified. Now, the drummer guy is just fucking King Kong. Get me on the drums, and I got no brain. I just got two fists and two, you know, sticks of wood in my hand and create mayhem on the drums. I don't think a lot. And that's sort of the problem, is that I don't think a lot. It's instinctive. And I just ride the hurricane, and it rides me. And that's kind of the way I enjoy playing. That seems to be what I've always done. Not always to the great pleasure of whoever is I'm playing with on stage and has to suffer through this blitzkrieg. but that's sort of what drums are about for me. By the way, when I play with orchestra, it's the same thing, only without the blitzkrieg. It's much more subtle and much more nuanced and quieter because since I wrote that music that the piccolo is playing, I had to play very quietly so that I can hear the piccolo that I wrote. So it's still very instinctive. I never play the same way twice in the night. The orchestra, the orcs, are all reading their score. Every single note, and not just what note it is, but how they play that note. The tenuto, the staccato, the articulation, everything, the crescendi, and all that is on the page, and they execute it beautifully and perfectly the same every night. And while they're doing it the same every night, I'm doing it not the same every night as the instinct takes, because I know where the music is. I know that it's right here, so I can take a left, and I can go in, I'll see it in four bars, because I know where the music's going to be at all times. And I can take these liberties because I wrote the music. And I can do that. And on the drums, I'm the same unthinking force of nature, but I know where the music is. And so it's a little easier on the ear, but it's the same instinctive style, same instinctive behavior.
And are drums still your go-to instrument? I mean, I know you play guitar, trombone, piano, and much more. What's your weapon of choice when you wake up and say, I want to jam today?
Drums and bass and guitar, sometimes the trombone. It depends, because the instruments are all at hand here. I walk past on my way to put on the kettle, and there's my trombone. I pick it up. By the way, it's a stretch to call me a trombonist, but I can get three notes out of the damn thing, which are pretty cool. I like getting those three notes. Guitar, I've got six or seven notes. add that to my five notes so that I know on the bass, and hey, you got some music going here.
Speaking of jamming, tell me about the Sacred Cove. It's where you at the moment, right?
Yes, I'm standing as we speak in the Sacred Grove, and it is my studio disguised as not a studio. Now, I've got all these instruments here. I've got the largest collection of the cheapest instruments money can buy. I got trombone, I got tuba, I got cello, I got gong drum, I got timpani, I got snare drum, I got Gibson SG, Stratocaster, and all kinds of instruments. And they're all plugged in. They're all mic'd up. The whole, just nobody ever comes in here but me, and I'm basically a glorified roadie, and I love wiring up shit. I've got a microphone on everything, and every microphone is plugged in, and it's got its preamp, and it's all tweaked, and I got the sound dialed in. So any instrument here is ready to go. I have a template. I just hit record, and the whole room is in record. And so my chuckle buddies come over, whether it's Chad Smith or Neil Peart or Snoop Dogg or Ben Harper, Stanley Clark, or any, you know, my buddies come over, and I just put the whole room in record, and we go for it. And I also have six cameras around the room, and they just sit there. They're locked off. I turn them on and leave them, and they can run for 6 hours. And my buddies come over, and they forget the cameras are on, and the room is recording, but everything's in recording. They can pick up this, you know, start playing around the Hammond organ, and that's right. I got two mics on that Leslie cabinet. It's going to tape. And I'm burning waveform, regardless if anyone picks up the Hammond or not, it's recording. And so I get these jam sessions, which are a lot of fun. We spend the evening laughing and chuckling and jamming. And then the next morning I come in with a titanic hangover and cut it all up. I cut that 15-minute, you know, we got several different jams, and I cut them down into manageable, you know, the best parts. And I've got the camera footage as well, so I cut together a little video of the proceedings, and I put them up online for all the children to enjoy. You can find them if you go to YouTube and look for, you know, Snoop Dogg at the Sacred Grove, or Stanley Clark, Sacred Grove, or Taylor Hawkins, Sacred Grove. You'll find them.
Yeah, I saw a few of those, and like you said, there's a little bit of post-production in them. It's not just you recording. Is that just for your personal enjoyment, or do you plan to release something one day, even if unofficially?
Releasing it would be very complicated, and I'd have to go to all their managers. I have to go to Jeff Lynne's manager, and he's going to say, well, wait a minute, we got an album coming. You know, it's like, oh, God. And the fun of it was the jam on the night, but I also enjoy the 2 weeks that it takes me in post-production, because I edit it myself, and it's just a fun exercise. But to actually make a commercial product out of it is sort of too complicated, and what the hell? It's pretty low resolution anyway, so I'll just put it up there for all the children to enjoy for free.
It'll be a copyright nightmare, that's for sure. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, speaking of Sacred Cove, you jammed with Neil Peart of Rush there on many occasions, like you said. How did the friendship between the two of you develop?
I was introduced to Neil by Les Claypool years and years and years ago. And we all went to the South Park Halloween party where I met Matt and Trey. And we just got along real well. And we've stayed in touch. And I even became a Rush fan, which is kind of a stretch. They know that over the years I had said some unkind words about Rush. Not because I had any problem with them. It's just that they were the epitome of when we were the police and we were struggling and, you know, iconoclasts and anything that was there, the establishment, we want to burn it all down, and we would criticize the Grateful Dead and Rush and anybody who was there before us with love in our hearts, no real ill will. Then years, I get to know all these people, and they turn out to be really great folks. And I regret it all. And they're so Canadian that they're over it. They couldn't care less, you know. They laugh about it.
Yeah, I bet. So you actually came to enjoy Rush music eventually, or?
Well, I enjoy the Rush people more than I enjoy the Rush music.
Okay, fair enough.
Well, I went to a couple of their shows, and live, I get it. They're three incredible musicians. And it's a style of music that I don't really, you know, I appreciate David Bowie as well, but I don't ever put on a David Bowie record, you know, but I understand that he was a seminal figure And so similarly, there's, you know, every musician's like this. You have people that you like personally, and you respect them and what they've contributed to the zeitgeist, but, you know, you don't have to be a fan of many of my best friends in music. I'm not necessarily a fan of their music. And there are some people that I am a fan of their music, but the guy's a fucking dickhead.
Yeah, you have both sides.
Like, unrelated.
Let me ask you about soundtracks, if I can. You've done so many at this point. I mean, what kind of input do you get from the directors when you set to do one?
Well, I don't do it anymore. I've retired from that. Oh. Now I write opera, which is the same job, but I get to be the boss. And yes, when you're scoring a film, you are not an artist, you are a craftsman. And the director is the artist, and you are there to serve his artistic vision. And he says, in this scene here, I need the audience to be suspicious of this character. And he's going to turn out to be a good guy, but when you first meet him, you've got to think he's an asshole. So I put asshole music on him at first, you know. And then later on, when we're supposed to start liking him, I put nice guy music on him. And during the course of this, as a professional, as a craftsman, rather than as an artist, you have to go places that you would not go as an artist. You know, Beck, as a musician, is a genius at following his instincts and going to where his instincts take him. But no one ever asked him to do a scene where, okay, it needs to be sad here. In fact, happy sad, and then get grim, and then get happy again, and then, you know, he doesn't have to do that because he's an artist. If that's not where his heart's going, then he doesn't do it. But a professional has to. And thereby, you learn things that you would not have learned otherwise. There was one little film that I scored where they used Rodgers and Hammerstein. They bought the rights to Rodgers and Hammerstein Broadway hits, and they wanted me to create a black comedy score out of this stuff. So I had to learn all this crap music. I never would have listened to that music in a million years, but they paid me good money, so I did. And by the way, wow, those guys really knew what they were doing. Now, I don't like it necessarily, but I sure did learn a lot from working with that and seeing their technique, because they are obviously masters of what they did. And so I never would have worked with an orchestra, but Francis Coppola turns around and says, I need strings. Okay. So I got to go figure out strings, and benefited from all of this stuff. I had an enforced music education, and I was paid for all of it.
Oh, wow. That's pretty cool.
And which, by the way, I use that now in opera. And for art's sake. Now, once again, in opera, I am the artist.
Last question for me. We spoke about your bands, writing for orchestras, an art project, movie scores. We didn't talk about polo, but you're a man of many interests. Do you think that your diverse upbringing, born in the U.S., raised in Beirut, lived in London, do you think that has something to do with it? Because you don't seem to ever stop.
I don't know. I think the growing up in Beirut was a factor in a cultural identity that is not standard, but I don't know. I just do what I do, and so does everyone else. And I am very fortunate and thankful that what I do is fun and interesting, and that people could give a shit.
I bet there's a lot more than you think of that give a shit about that, man. But anyway, it's been a pleasure, man. I hope this COVID thing goes away soon enough so that we can see you live ASAP.
Yeah, where are you?
I'm in Toronto.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Give them hell up there.
I will try.
You're surrounded by Canadians.
I am. I'm Brazilian, but I live here now, so.
That's a good mix.
Yeah, it is. Thanks, man. Thank you so much.
Sure thing. All right, take care now.
You too. Bye. Okay, everyone, thank you for tuning in, and I hope you enjoyed this interview with the amazing Stewart Copeland. You can listen to it also on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, and iHeartRadio. Also, please follow us on Twitter and Facebook, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We're going to finish with the song Stark Naked from Gizmodrome. Take care, and rock on.